This week, we are going to try to understand a very controversial point in the parasha. And we try to learn what the Rishonim says about it, and then we try to, based on this, to find maybe a new direction, a new way to understand, hopefully, Bezrat Hashem. In this week, there is a big clash, a big argument between a teacher and a student, between Sarah and Hagar. The Midrash says, and Rashi brings it on the parasha, that Hagar was the daughter of Paro. She was a princess. And she decided, her father decided, that it's better to be a maid in Abraham's house and wash the dishes and clean the floor than to be in the palace of her father. We show somebody is really devoted, He gave up something to become close to Sarah and Abraham. And during the years of them being together, Hagar became the most important student of Sarah. With her Yirat Shamayim and prayers and her devotion and a sacrifice. And Sarah really loved her. And before I continue, it's very interesting that the best student of Sarah was Hagar, that was Paro's daughter. And the best student of Abraham was Eliezer, that was Nimrod's son. Two kings that were not definitely from the fan club of Avraham Avinu, their children went against their parents' way and joined Avraham and Sarah. So, Sarah, she came to Israel, to Canaan. She was at the age of 65, and Avraham was 75. And they believe that when coming to Israel, they have to be more strict and they have to keep, you know, all the chumrot, even though there was no Torah. But they knew, you know, from their parents and grandparents, from Shem Ve'Ever Yeshiva. And they knew that after 10 years of living together without children, there is a ground, lo aleinu, for divorce. So after 10 years of living in Israel, and Sarah became already 75, and Abraham is 85, she realized, Sarah, that there is a basic ground of either divorcing or to give to Abraham to get married to a different woman. Abraham didn't say anything. Avraham is very quiet, and Sarah makes all the arrangements. So Sarah, she goes to Avraham and she says, I have to admit, Hashem doesn't give me children. I'm going to give you a permission to marry my maid Hagar. And maybe God will give me a child. One of the Mefarshim explains, what did she say? Jealousy is something which is very painful. So we say, maybe by me giving Hagar to Abraham, Hashem will see how much I'm willing to sacrifice, and is going to give me a child. Which is a very tough issue, but when she came to Hagar and she told to Hagar, Hagar told her, you are my Rebbetzin, you are my teacher, you are my mother. I don't feel that I have the right to go for this. Very nice So the Torah says, "Vatikach Sarah eshet Avraham," and Sarah, she took Hagar. As the Midrash bring, and Rashi says, "Lekachta bedvarim," she started to convince her. It's good, and she said, "Ashraich," you have to be very happy. Shezachit liyidabek beguf kadosh kaze. You have to be very happy. You have a chance to be connected to the holiest person that I know in this world. And it's beside of just being his wife. You're going to be connected to the holiness. And Hagar say no, and she say yes, and Hagar say no, and she say yes. And eventually, Sarah convinced Abraham and Hagar to get married. So Abraham and Hagar are getting together, and the Torah says, the Midrash says, and they say that after the first night, Hagar was informed that she is pregnant. Now, what should be now the situation? Hagar, she is the student, and she is a wonderful person, and she is very holy, and she is very religious. Sarah understood that she is going to be happy and say to Hashem, thank you. Hagar, she says, "Vatekal gvirta b'enea." Hagar started to disrespect Sarah. What kind of disrespect? When people came to a Rebbetzin, to Shiur Torah, and she was sitting in the front, she would tell them, the Midrash says, "I thought that Sarah, she is more religious, and she's closer to God more than I thought, so that she's more spiritual than it looked like." En sitra kegluya. If Hashem didn't give her pregnancy and give to me pregnancy, it means she is not as holy as she pretend to be. En sitra kegiluya. She looks very religious. Bashtot av nutri nito. Mara et atzma kiilu itzadeket. Like a show off, I am a big tzadeket. Veina tzadeket. Shelo zachta leirayon kol hashanim. She lived with Abraham 60 years, 50 years. And I, after 1 week of marriage, I'm already pregnant. Now, we have to see now the reaction of Sarah. And over here there is a big trap that unfortunately, if you're not sensitive enough, you can come to the wrong conclusion. So now it says that Sarah is screaming at Abraham, "Abraham, I'm very upset at you. If I'm asking you, what is the reason of Sarai at this moment? So you will tell me, she is not happy, she is speaking up on whoever she sees, nachon? Yes or no? She is screaming on Abraham. She say, God will judge us. And then it says she was upset at Hagar, and because of this, the child was miscarried. And she started to abuse Hagar, and she has to give all kind of hard working. Vata'aneh Sarai. And you will say, wait a minute, I disagree with her. She is our mother, she is everything, but hey, this is the will of Hashem. This is very easy to judge on this level, true? And even the Ramban, which one of the most important commentary on the Torah, he says the follow. ותענה השרי, חטאה אימנו בעינוי זה. She said, our mother, Sarah, she made a sin. She made a mistake. וגם אברהם, when he saw all this abuse and he was quiet, וגם אברהם בהניחו לעשות כן. Therefore, say the Rambam, her next child became Pere Adam, Ishmael, and since that time, he liked to torture the children of Abraham and Sarah. According to the Ramban, because of a wrong action, all the problem between Ishmael and Yitzchak started from there.
One action continues reaction.
Yes.
But only they could cause us problem only if we don't follow Hashem. If we follow Hashem, what kind of...
Yeah, but the permission of Pere Adam, of Ishmael, to hurt the children of Avraham and Sarah, of Yitzchak, and continue.
Because of this.
He got the ability. I read the Ramban, and it makes a lot of sense if you go by the text of the Torah. But I believe that we can go to a different direction with you tonight and learn something totally different.
How did she, how that connected, being pregnant and being spiritually, how she connected these two?
We have the tendency to go to a very fast judgment. Sure. We like to do it. And the people has this tendency to go to judgments, from judgments, 1 to 3, don't asking, no questioning. We are the judges, we are the executors. Then after that, they say, oh, we made a mistake. And no, it's a very common way of thinking. I'm sorry. I believe over here that the dispute between Sarah and Hagar was totally in a much different, higher level, which we have to learn it, because it applies to us today. Mm-hmm. I read the beautiful Gemara in Masechet Pesachim, Daf Mem Tet. And it says, Tanu Rabbanan, talk about wedding, marriages. Somebody asked me to talk about dating, so I'm going to make the mitzvah of tonight. Tanu Rabbanan, Le'olam imkor adam kol ma sheyesh lo v'yisa bat talmid chacham. Sell all your money and invest to marry a daughter of a talmid chacham, of Torah scholar. וישיב איתו לתלמיד חכם. And look for his daughter, for somebody who is תלמיד חכם. What is the comparison? משל, ענבי הגפן בענבי הגפן. Grapes, wine. You take two kinds of grapes and make a wine. The wine has tendency, when the time goes by, it's become better. You buy the harvest of 1970, 1900, this, and each of them makes in more and more and more money. But Omeret HaGemara, but never marry your daughter to somebody which is totally ignorant and totally out of the way. Am Haaretz, we call him. Lama? Because it's like Inve HaGefen be Inve HaSne. What is a sne? Sne is a bush with thorns. So I was saying about over here, based on the Gemara, why the Torah choose from all the thorns just the sne? You can say, you know, you can say sabres, you can say whatever. Why are you using the word of sne? So based on this, I say that sne is 3,500 years ago, almost. Once for a few hours, Hashem was a guest of the Sneh. Since day on, he doesn't give pakoina to nobody. He doesn't give rest to nobody. You know who I am? I am the Sneh. You are a throne? No. For 3 hours, I was hosting Hashem. But it happened 3,000 years ago. How can you say, you know who I am? Omeret HaGemara, this kind of shiduchim will not work out. Lama, you're talking about people that their ego from here until Antarctica or Australia. So, as the Gemara says, Istara balagina kish kish karya. Know what does it mean? You know what does it mean? If you put in the lagan, if you put one penny and you shake it, you're going to get at least $2 million over there by the voice. Like in Tkash Choli, nothing inside. So, Sarah say, I took this girl, a princess, I gave her a good education, I made her very close to me, I taught her everything, and she was praying like a lulav, and she was reading, you know, like a real tzaddeket, reading Tehillim and Tikkun HaKlali and this, and Perek Shira and everything, you know. But after 1 week, she became pregnant. She started to judge. Who is Sarah? Who is Abraham? Who is me? You know what we're talking about. She is not as religious as I was thinking. Then he cried, Inveasne, Inveasne. Oh, because something happened. It's already for her, the whole, everything is so clear cut. Sarah is telling to Abraham, I'm sorry, but it was a big mistake. I cannot build with her the house of Israel. And even though she progressed in Irat Shamayim, something in her genes will prevent her to grow up. She can be a good religious for one generation, 60 years, 50 years. But when the foundation are very weak, they say it cannot last, and I cannot let this connection to continue. We think that it was something she did to abuse Sarah, the hardship that she went through her life, being harassed and kidnapped by Avimelech, by Paroi, and never complained, and going from one immigration to other, it was a different level. But she saw that the person that she's trusted so much, the foundation are not strong. So we say, I cannot waste my time. Abraham and Sarah start to argue. Sarah is telling to Abraham, God will judge. What he will judge? Abraham bet. Basically told to Sarah, you know, maybe there is a human component over here, you know, husband and wife, children, pregnancies. She said, okay, ask Hashem, he knows better. In the next argument between Sarah and Abraham, when Ishmael is born and Sarah is telling to Abraham, you know, send him and his mother, please. Nebinam nesozamrim b'yiddish. Padalshe. And Abraham is telling her, what happened? Vayiradavar. Hashem is telling to Abraham, when it's come to prophecy, she is number one and you're number two. Dumb. Hashem is telling to Abraham, you can think that she is a wife, she's jealous, this son, why is that? And he's saying, no. She in Nevuah in prophecy, Omer HaMidrash, Sheata Tafel LeNevuah Mimena. Hashem is telling to Abraham, Abraham, you are a big tzaddik, you are Avraham Avinu. But when it's coming about the future, you have to listen to her. So basically, Sarai and Hagar are not arguing about who got pregnant first. The real argument is the connection between Ishmael and Yitzchak is going to be beneficial or not. Is it going to help Am Israel to progress or not? Avraham is the father of everybody. He believed that he can make working together. Sarah told him, even though you are the father, but from the mother's side, there is all kind of energies. This argument or this dispute continues in a much deeper level after a few years. What happened after a few years? Another two boys are born. Yaakov and Esav. But over here is much different situation. It's not two mothers. It's one mother and one father. Happened to me, nice people, cousins. Everything sounds good. And but over there, it's a much interesting thing. And there is the Torah is telling us, the Midrash brings it, a very interesting story, very weird story. But after Rivka, Yitzchak's wife, she got pregnant after 20 years. She started to feel a problem. Whenever she goes next to synagogue, she feels the child wants to go out, to come out. Whenever she goes next to a movie theater, he wants to go out. She say, what happened over here? Is something with bipolar, all kind of two different people? And it says over there, and she went to her grandfather ever. He was a very old man. He was Shem's grandson. And she told him, tell me what's the story. ותלך לדרוש את השם, אומר רש"י, לבית מדרשו של שם. שם ועבר. And he's telling her, you have two children, you have twins, but they are separate from the creation. Each of them will go to different direction. One will like to go to Halloween celebration tonight. And one will love to come to hear a Dvar Torah in one of the shiurim tonight. And then, Baruch Hashem, she was relieved because she thought if it's in the same person, then she has a problem, you know. But she said, okay, two, at least I have one. And the child were born, and they start to grow up, and another dispute starts. Yitzchak is telling to Rivka, I think both of them can work together and they can continue Am Israel. And Rivka is telling him, I have a problem. My grandfather says that one of them is a lost case. Yitzchak didn't want to accept it. And this dispute was going on and on and on and on for many years. At the age of 123, when Yitzchak was, it means when the kids were 63 years old, they come to a realization. When Rivka is making a whole show over there of Yaakov and Esav and clothing and changing and hands and skin and furs and everything. And when Yaakov comes to get the bracha, Yitzchak sees him, and Hashem is telling him, he is the one. He said, I don't know who is this. Hashem said, I don't care, you don't know. Just give a blessing. Therefore, when Esav is coming in afterwards, and he starts to cry, Yitzchak says, I'm sorry. I got an email from the Himmel, and they told me that give bracha, so. So what is the, so it was another kind of separation. We have to wait many years to go, and we come to another dispute in the family between Yaakov's children. Yaakov has four wives, he has 12 children, 12 boys and one girl, and suddenly start to see another separation. We call it in Russian grupirovka. Two groups, one anti-Yosef and one for Yosef. And Yaakov Avinu is wondering now. Do we have to continue another generation or not? Because when you start this, he wants to come to a point that people start to live together. And he starts to feel there are two groups. And he sees how they start to hate each other. And now there is a big question. Will it be? Or I have to wait another generation? And then the Torah says that Yaakov is calling to Yosef. Yosef is 17 years old. And Yaakov is telling him, he's calling him, and he tells him, it's very interesting. Usually we call Yaakov, Yaakov, but suddenly it says in this pasuk, Vayomer Israel el Yosef, not Yaakov. Now we're talking about Yaakov, he got elevation. Now we talk like Israel. He said to Yosef, your brothers are in Shechem. Go there. And he tell him, he say, no problem. So we say, Lechna re'e shlom achicha. See, are they peaceful? Yeah. Or basically he's telling him, go to make peace. Nachon? And then, v'ashiveni davar. Then, talk to me. Yosef is going over there, and when they see him, what they say? Let's kill him, finish. V'yitnaklu la'amito. Brothers, Am Yisrael chai. Let's kill him. And they're talking about chaya ra'a, bad animals, and talking about, and they bring shechina, and they make beidin, and make this, all things they want to kill their own brother. It says it says something very interesting. It says when Yaakov is sending Yosef, Katuv, Vaishlacheu me'emek Hebron, and he sent him from the valley of Hebron. Omer ha-midrash, ve'alo Hebron bahar, Hebron is a mountain. Ela, the Midrash brings, Ela me'etza amuka shel oto tzadik ha-kavur b'chevron. You understand? Yaakov is saying, over here, my grandfather is buried, Abraham. Nachon? Abraham and Sarah are fighting about what? Can I walk with this couple or not? Do we have to go to the next generation? So now Yaakov, Vaishlacheu me'etza amuka, shel oto tzadik ha-kavur b'chevron, Yitzchak v'Sara, I'm sorry, Avraham v'Sara, he's telling over here, I want to see if the dispute for a few hundred years, if it's going to be resolved this time or not. You understand? We are talking about, are we finished with this? Or still will be another, yes, no, he's the good, he's the one, he has to be killed, he has to be sent away. And they're selling Yosef, and then you know all the story when they come to Egypt after many years and they're looking and they see Yosef. What was the point that Yosef revealed himself as Yosef? I was thinking, when he became a king, he's going to send to his father a check and a Bentley, come to Egypt. Yosef is quiet. Why are you quiet? Your father is suffering on the floor, struggling. Yosef is telling them, my father told me, make peace then come. Now we are in peace, he's not in peace. You have to make a peace. We are not peaceful now. So, when Yosef revealed himself, you remember? What was the word that broke all this, that Yosef understood that he can say to his father that the mission was complete, you know? We say, Vayigash, Avogash, we say in Bukharian, right? So we say that Yehuda coming to to Yosef. Yosef is telling him, I'm going to make Binyamin like this. You can go, I have no problem. Ve'az Yehuda is saying to Yosef like this. Ki avdecha, because I, Omer Yehuda, arav et anar. מה זה ערב? I am responsible. אנחנו ערבים. We are committed to each other. יוסף אמר, if you are committed, if you are going to fight and give your life for one of your brothers, it means that now I can say to my father that the mission was accomplished. And then he told to Yehuda, I'm going to, I'm Yosef. Go tell to my father. For many years, there is a midrash that I never understood. And tonight, thanks to you, I was able to understand it. When Yaakov heard about Yosef being alive, he didn't believe them. But when he saw the agalot, the carriages,
the Bentley.
Ketuv, Vayar et ha'agalot, v'techi roach Yaakov aviyem. After he saw the agalot, the carriages, now we believe them. And I heard many, what agalot, they say that you learn agla arufa, that agala is a carriage, and agla it's a calf. And then agalot, and I never understood, what is the connection? Why you have to see the agalot? And to say, you know what? Now I understand that the Yosef is alive. Huh? Eza agala. Maybe we can say ba'agala with Zman Karif. But today, thanks to you, I saw a midrash, Mebalei HaTosafot, and suddenly it becomes so simple. He says that when Yaakov saw the agalot, he started to get back his power of prophecy. And the first thing that he saw is the six carriages that were used by the Levim to build the Mishkan. Shesh agalot sav. What's the connection? Mishkan, shesh agalot. What did he see? Now we can understand and really enjoy it. So I opened in Sefer Bamidbar, we're talking about these carriages. In Sefer Parashat Naso, if you're going to see, you're going to see the 12 presidents, each of them brought his own gift. But there is one thing that they gave by couples, six carriages. 12 presidents, it has to give two. So they have to share. So Yaakov was all the time thinking, he said, if they are separated, they're going to give alone, but to share with each other is going to be very difficult. The only item that you have to bring together is the six carriages. Every two has to bring one. And suddenly, Yaakov understands that, thank God, we don't have to go to another separation, to another generation. 12 brothers were able to care for each other. So he understood that the dispute between Abraham and Sarah was finished in the time when he saw the six carriages. Because it's not one president has to bring it. It has to be two. You know that there is one synagogue we like to go, one synagogue we don't go on principle. We have this kind of last week there was a very not nice event, and I have to speak to somebody. It was very difficult to convince him. There was, in one of the synagogues, there was an event, and they put flyers. So they came to one other synagogue and they threw the flyer, then it was removed after half an hour. So they put another one, it was removed. So they told him, why you removed it? He said, because over there you're not allowed to go. Amati is such nice shalom and Jewish way of thinking and walking about things. You can put the flyer, you cannot go by yourself, but why to remove it? But of course it's L'Shem Shamayim, and of course it's so not Jewish. This dispute, we are running away for the last 3,000 years, but Baruch Hashem, all the time this
getting
stronger, like Hagar descendants, that who I am, and she's judging, and this, you know. So, זה נקרא שש הגלות צו. יעקב אינו, suddenly he sees הגלות, and he sees suddenly the הגלות of בית המשגש, he says, oh, now I can go. And when he sees Yosef, what he's telling Yosef, I can die now. Why you die now? Why to die now? He said, because the mission was accomplished to the utmost satisfaction. We are now one. Am Israel. So, when Hagar, she's trying to... She's not punishing, Sarah doesn't punish Hagar. She didn't punish Hagar. It was not the issue. But if somebody really believes in Judaism and he starts to be judgmental and he starts to judge people because something good happened to him, it shows that he never understood what Judaism is all about. It wasn't a punishment. It was a realization. This question we have all the time. People come to me to ask me this question about somebody that comes from a powerful family and he became very religious. And they ask me, Rabbi, would you think he's going to hold on to it? Does he have the power to do it? Which is a very difficult question to ask, to answer. Because if when you whatever you bring from your family, even though you're growing up, it's still there. And how strong you are to be all the time on alert, not to accept it, not to accept this, and to know what Hashem wants from you. I believe that as we started the dispute, the misunderstanding or the pain of Sarah was that she really believed that Hagar, she is going to grow up and become a real Jew. But to start to judge other people, to judge the rabbi, maybe she become too Jewish, but to judge the rabbi. But because it's very common in every community. But to go, you know, far beyond your capacity of judgment, this is something which really gave a sign to Sarah that it's just the beginning of a journey. It's not the end of a journey. Abraham is the father of everybody. Abraham was able to like everybody. Yitzchak is the power. Yitzchak is so strong that the Gemara, once I told her, Masechet Shabbat brings that when the evil inclination, the Yetzer Hara, was complaining about Am Yisrael to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, so Yitzchak is telling to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, how many years people are average life? 70 years, 35 years they are sleeping, 12 years they are working, 12 this, so 7 years left. So the majority is already okay. And if you don't like it, you know, I take that on my account. Yitzchak has the power to see through all the evil of the world and to see, you know, there is no evil, you know, there is nothing, there is just image, it's just nothing, it's just garnish. But for Sarah and Rivka, they in the Nevuah, they knew, they say, okay, you know, you can say very good things about Esav, very good about Ishmael, but they're very dangerous. They're very dangerous. And the life, the history showed us how wide they were. So it wasn't a punishment, it was not, as you say before, when Am Yisrael, Akol Kol Yaakov, Adai Medei Esav, it's kind of, when Am Yisrael become weak, spiritually, they're getting power. But I think this is the beauty of the of our parents, Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov. Their war is about 500 years from now, 1,000 years from now, 2,000 years from now. This is what we call a father. We'll finish with it. Rav Ben David once say, we have in our religion, we have our seven prophets, but each of them has different nickname. Avraham is our father. Yitzchak is the father. Yaakov is the father. Moshe is the teacher, not the father. Aaron is the Kohen, the one to give blessing. Yosef is Tzaddik. And David is the king. They say, why do we call Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov fathers and all? Everybody can be our father. And he explains that the concept of being a father and a mother to a child, we judge it in one way. Are you thinking about 20 years from now, 40 years from now, 100 years from now? You are a father. If you're thinking about tomorrow morning, you are a teacher maybe, or you are a neighbor maybe, but you're not a father. To be a father is to think ahead of the time. There is a beautiful Masechet Gemara, Masechet Megillah, the Gemara says over there, Hashem is telling to Yaakov Avinu, there will be the Nazism in the world, and they would like to destroy many Jews. They talk about 3,500 years later. And Yaakov is praying, and Yaakov is saying, no, and please help us. If I will tell you something in 3,000 years, you will tell me, you know, Rabbi. Let's talk about Monday morning.
Avraham had more children from Hagar. What happened to them? He knew that Sarah disliked the idea to have children from Hagar because it's not no continuation. Why continue more?
The Midrash goes like this. Yitzchak went and brought Hagar back and told to Avraham, Am Israel will continue from me. But let's live the life as Hashem told to Avraham and to all of us. At this moment, they are good, we'll take it like this. It's not a contradiction. It will last one generation, two generations, but they have to multiply. This is the mitzvah. So she converted, she became a good Jew, and they lived with another six boys he had from her. But they were lost in the history. But Yitzchak told him, it's two different issues. Am Israel will continue from me. But you're talking about the beginning. Be very careful in the beginning when you build a family. I tell to all my students, don't make mistakes. You are newlywed. Don't make mistakes. Somebody came to me this week, and he said, Rabbi Yeshua, I want to honor you. You are my rabbi. I respect you, me and my wife. I tell him, what is the good news?
What's
the case? He say, my wife, she's going to have now a baby boy, and you should be the Sandak. I told him, but wait a minute. You have a father, she has a father. Why you come to me? No, we decided that from Shalom Bayit we give it to you. Amarti lahem. You just got married. You have to go by the tradition. Your father is going to be the first sandak. Then you're going to be your father, the second sandak. Then you're going to be, I won't oppose, but at this moment you're making a mistake. Why? We decided we are going to respect you. You made us religious thanks to you, everything. I told them, no. You have to think, because this kind of thing can destroy all your marriage life for the next 50 years, as long as your parents are around. God bless them. So, but sometimes the way that, he told me, but they are not religious, they become now an excuse. I told him, so you're not religious too. So when I took you, And maybe I didn't ask you about religious, not religious. So it took me a while, but I convinced him that you have to think, because now you're building the house of Israel, you and your wife, you cannot make mistakes. Now is just the beginning.
A lot of the times you gotta make a mistake in order to learn.
You hear me?
Really.
It's not necessarily. You can ask if you want. If you don't ask, you want to make a mistake, it doesn't make sense. You cannot risk for small things a whole relationship. And it's really small, you know. And how many cases I have of young couples that with small mistake doesn't mean anything. It's like so much damage. And the kids suffer, and the parents suffer, and they suffer. And be very, 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 very careful not to make these mistakes. And you know, if I'm going to tell you stories, you have to write 3 books for this. What? Of what? Shlomo HaMelech, his wrong judgment was that he thought that he's going to bring now the Mashiach time. Shalom, Shalem, Akol, like everything is Bet HaMikdash. Akol Mukhan. But sometimes when everything is ready, you have to be more ready. And if you're going to take one step ahead of the time, it can go, it can backfire. And this life is so, so complicated. God should bless us and guide us in the right way to continue to build the house of Israel in the spirit of Yaakov and his children, Yosef HaTzadik, Yehuda, Chen Yirasamenu Maramim.